So welcome again, this time to session 8. During this session, we are going to look at two features of these writings. Number one, the authenticity, a specific test for authenticity. And number two, a top feature of these writings. I think you will enjoy them. So the question of authenticity first. Here's the question. Does the writing and literature contain and describe a test that an inquirer could use to determine its authenticity, meaning evidence that the message came to the human race from a source that could be classed supernatural in nature and quality? You see, these messages claim to have come from the other world, from the other dimension. You and I can't go there. We've never been there. So how do we know these messages came from there, from the other supernatural dimension? So the question here is there anything in the writing that describes a test within the writing to help us determine whether it's authentic or not? We will look carefully at whatever the claims are. So let's look at the literature in terms of its authenticity or whether it gave us an authentic test. Hinduism, here are the words. We have to accept it as it is. Otherwise, there is no point in trying to understand the Bhagavad Gita and its speaker, Lord Krishna. In other words, the Hindu literature do not describe a test within the literature. It's there for you to take, or if you don't like it, discard. Check it out with your own ideas, but there is no real test that is described there. How about Buddhism? Genuine realization of the emptiness of the phenomenon world is a direct intuition of the highest truth. Absolute truth is unconditional, undeterminate, and beyond thought and word. Did you notice the word intuition and the fact that it's beyond thought and word? So Buddhist literature also does not describe a test within the writings. So both Hinduism and Buddhism do not describe a test inside the writings. However, they do describe a test, and that is a test of experience. This is what they say. Go ahead and check it out in your experience. See how it pans out in real life, and then you will know how authentic these writings are. It's a good test, and actually quite a bold test. The problem with that test is that every other religion also has the same test. I have not found any religion or religious writing that says, just read it and you'll get to the destination. No, every writing describes a test which you are supposed to put into your life, experience, and then you will get to the next step and the next life. So Buddhism and Hinduism do not describe a test within the writings. How about Islam? We do have a test. It says, produce one chapter comparable to it, to the Quran. Call upon your idols to assist you if what you say is true. But if you fail, as you are sure to fail, in fact, if men and jinn are a type of creatures in between humans and angels, if men and jinn combine to produce a book akin to this Quran, they would surely fail to produce its like. Or even 10 chapters, and maybe even one chapter, it says in Surah 10 and Ayah 38. So here's a test. And so I was quite pleased with that. I said, wow, that's a good test. Let me go and check it out. But the moment I tried to do the test, four things actually block the test. Here are the four. It does not describe what aspect to be equaled. If you ask me to equal so-and-so, the first question I will ask is, in what aspect should I equal? In looks, or in height, or complexion, or in intellectual ability, or in grades, or physical prowess? What aspect? It does not mention the specific aspect to be compared. Number two, what would be the method of comparison? How shall we do the test? Is it a subjective method or objective method in which we give grades so that this one gets 20 and that one gets 25, so to 25 wins? It does not describe the method of comparison. It also does not say who will be the judge. Will it be the individual reading it? Will it be a certain imam or a mullah in one of the masjids? Will it be a neutral committee like maybe from the United Nations? Well, it does not describe who will be the judge. By default then, the person who is reading and doing the test is the judge. If that is the case, then if you ask me, I feel that there are other writings which I cannot ever say is inferior to the Quran, at least in its beauty and its prose and its meaning and the message that it brings. Arabic writings too. Khalil Gibran, Jalaluddin Rumi are to name a few. Beautiful writing. It's hard to say that it's worse than the Quran. So, who will be the judge? Not very sure. The last of the four points that block the test is the language. The Quran is the Quran only in the Arabic language, because the claim is that this Quran came down from Allah, from his mother book, which he keeps in heaven, and that book is in Quran. That book is in Arabic. So Arabic is the only language in which you can describe the message from Allah. It's not just the words, it is the sound of the words and the rhythm and the rhyme that it produces. That is what is Arabic, and that is what is really the language of Allah. So, how many people on earth know that kind of an Arabic? The fact is, the spoken Arabic in the Arabian Peninsula is not really the Arabic of the Quran. It is very literal. It's beautiful. So, how many people know that? Less than 1%. So, more than 99% of the human population does not know that Quran. So, the test cannot be done by all of us. Therefore, it loses its universal test, the universal quality of that test. So I could not test the Quran. So I went to the Judeo-Christian scriptures. I put them two together, the Judaic and the Christian scriptures, and you'll see the reason why. But before I get to that, I would like to describe a certain statement by a French atheistic brilliant scientist. His name is Pere Simon Laplace. He described many, many, many years ago what he called as scientific determinism. Here's what he said. We may regard the present state of the universe as the effect of its past and the cause of its future. An intellect which at a certain moment would know all the forces that set nature in motion and all positions of all items which nature is composed, if this intellect were also vast enough to submit these data for analysis, it would embrace in a single formula the movements of the greatest bodies of the universe and those of the tiniest atom. For such an intellect, nothing would be uncertain, and the future, just like the past, would be present before its eyes. It's amazing that an atheist would use the word intellect apart from human intellect, and also give it some human characteristics like seeing and eyes, but he did it. So what we are looking at is this claim that if there is an intellect that knows every particle in the universe, knows every property of every particle, knows every law that governs every particle, then to that intellect nothing would be uncertain. He could look past, he'd look to the future, and he would know everything. For example, if he looked at the atoms that make up this pointer, this intellect could go back 200 years and tell us exactly where each atom was and what happened in the 200 years to make it into a pointer. Further, he could look future, into the future, 200 years, say, and say where every atom from this pointer would be 200 years from now. So he could, for example, predict the future. Suppose the intellect sat here, how would we test that intellect to say, yep, we found that you are the intellect? Well, one way would be to ask him or her, it, that intellect, tell us what will happen next week, and then maybe next month, and then maybe next year, or 5 years from now, or 10 or 50 years from now, and then keep a record and find out whether those predictions came true. And if all of them came true, well, then we might have identified that intellect. Do you know that that is the exact test that is found in the Judeo-Christian scriptures? Here's what it says. Present your case, says the Lord. Bring them forth and show us what will happen. Declare to us things to come. Show the things that are to come hereafter, that we may know that you are gods. Isaiah used the word gods. We could easily put the word intellect, that we may know that you are that intellect. It's called predictive prophecy. But just any prophecy or any prediction is not really impressive as a predictive prophecy. So here are 5 points that Douglas Kruger says would point to a real, genuine prophecy. Number one, it should be clear with enough detail to specifically describe the event to be fulfilled. Number two, it should be unusual or unique and not a common everyday occurrence. Number three, it should be made prior to the event that was supposed to be its fulfillment. Number four, it should not be the sort that could be the result of an educated guess. And number five, it should not be staged or manipulated to intentionally cause its fulfillment. So with these criteria, let's look at one prophecy that's written in the Bible. Jeremiah was a prophet, and he wrote about Babylon. He said, I will make her springs dry, and also that Babylon shall become a heap without an inhabitant. He wrote this about 595 BC, when Babylon was at its zenith, the most fortified, the most strong city in the world. Now, Cyrus the Medo-Persian was winning all his wars until he came to Babylon. He eyed Babylon because he said if he gets Babylon, he would be world emperor. So his aim, his ambition was to get Babylon. But how would he defeat Babylon, that fortified city? Do you know how wide the walls of Babylon are? Our walls are about 18, 24 inches thick. The walls of Babylon were double-walled. And today when you look at the archaeological finds, they say it's up to 87 thick in width, the wall that big. How can you break down that wall? How high did the wall go? Anywhere from 175 to 300 feet. So if you want to climb over the wall, you would have to get a ladder close to the wall. But you can't get a ladder close to the wall because it is surrounded by a moat. And the volume of the moat was equal to the volume of the wall. Well, the only way to win against such a fortified, strong, powerful city was to lay siege. But if you must lay siege, that means keep your soldiers at the gate and don't let anybody go in and out, because the food has to come from outside the city into the city for the people. And you just pay your soldiers to sit and watch the gate. And you must be extremely rich and have a lot of money in your coffers to pay your soldiers just to sit and watch. So it's hard to have a long, drawn-out siege. 1 year, 1.5 years, maybe 2 years, 2.5 years maximum. Do you know why the people inside Babylon would laugh at anybody wanting to lay siege to it? Because in the storehouses in Babylon, there was enough food for every one of its inhabitants for a period of 20 years. Now, how are you going to beat that kind of a city? But it fell. You see, Babylon was situated on the river Euphrates. It ran from one end and out the other end of the city. It was the water supply of the city. Cyrus the Medo-Persian, according to Herodotus the historian, was looking for a way into the city. One day his horse, as he passed through one of the rivers, drowned in the river. He was so upset, it was the river Euphrates. He called his generals and he said, this river killed my horse. I want this river dry. So do you know what the generals and the soldiers did? They actually got together and dug anywhere from 80 to 300 canals, aqueducts, paralleling the river Euphrates and drained it. What happened? It was drained. Cyrus saw his way into the city on the riverbed. And Babylon fell in one night without a single drop of bloodshed. Wow. After that, Babylon gradually deteriorated until today, just a heap of ruins. Here's what Smithsonian says. Few words evoke as many images of ancient decadence, glory, and prophetic doom as does Babylon. Yet the actual place 50 miles south of Baghdad is flat, hot, deserted, and dusty. That's amazing. You don't have to be a believer. Just get a ticket to Baghdad and you can see the ruins even today. So did the prophecy come true? Her springs were dry. That was the prophecy. And even today, it's a heap of rubble. Nobody lives there at all. 2,500 years and that prophecy still stands. How about another one? The description of where somebody would be born. The town was named Bethlehem. The fulfillment is described in the New Testament, Bethlehem. The prophetic date was 500 BC and it occurred in 4 BC, more than 500 years. How about yet another prophecy? Psalms, which was written 1,000 years before Jesus, says, "As for my thirst, they gave me vinegar to drink." And the story in the New Testament says about Jesus, he said, "I thirst," and they filled a sponge with sour wine and put it to his mouth, same as vinegar. 1,000 years earlier? Scholars report that they have identified 600 prophecies in the Judeo-Christian scriptures. 322 refer to a single individual, Jesus the Christ. 24 of them were fulfilled over just one weekend, the last weekend of his life. Now, how many would impress you? I had thought when I looked at that in the beginning, 10 or 12 would be more than enough. But look at how many there are. Look at these statistics. Peter Stoner considers 48 prophecies and reports, we find the chance that any one man fulfilled all 48 prophecies to be one chance in 10 to the power of 157. That is a really large number. We saw earlier that the total amount of chance this universe provides is 10 to the power of 122. So if the total number of chances provided by the entire universe since its inception is 10 to the power of 122, and we require 10 to the power of 157 chances to have this done, 48 in just one individual, it would require a series of 10 to the power of 35 consecutive universes. One followed by 35 zeros, that many universes to have this deal and this event actually take place by itself. Therefore, the prophecies were real, not by chance. Look at this statement. Two statements, one by Pierre-Simon Laplace and the second by a respected believer, Ellen G. White, who is acknowledged as the most prolific non-science writer in American history. Look at the words, the highlighted words. "For such an intellect," says Pierre-Simon Laplace, "nothing would be uncertain. The future, just like the past, would be present before its eyes." And the next statement by the believer, "He that ruleth in the heavens," same as the intellect, "is the one who sees the end from the beginning, the one whom before whom the mysteries of the past and the future are alike outspread." Same words. So multiple sources saying the same thing. A brilliant atheistic scientist saying the same thing as a respected believer. The words are found in an ancient sacred literature and is verifiable by today's present-day secular history. That's amazing. So what about the Judeo-Christian book so far? The New Testament is the best historical literature, least gaps in time, greatest manuscript evidence, we saw that, and the authors were part of the story. And today, the only writing, the Judeo-Christian scriptures, that permits an open test for possible supernatural origin. And now for the top features of these different writings. The language of the Quran in Islam. It's stated to be exquisitely beautiful. The prose and the row and the rhythm and the way it expresses its truths. When they listen to it, they feel enveloped in a divine dimension of sound. One day, Umar al-Khattab was so upset with Muhammad that he took his sword and he wanted to kill him because he thought he was bringing heresy to the town. Before he went there, somebody asked him to go back home. And when he went back home, there he found the Quran being read in his own house. He was so upset and angry that he physically and forcefully chased them out. They ran helter-skelter, leaving the Quran on the floor. He picked it up and he read the 20th chapter to which it was open. And he read it carefully and this is what he said. "How fine and noble is this speech," he said wonderingly. And this Muslim was felled, brought to his knees by the beauty of the Quran, which reached through his passionate hatred and prejudice to an inner receptivity that he had not been aware of. He put the sword back in its sheath, walked down the streets to Muhammad, declared that he was now a converted Muslim on the spot within the hour because of the beauty of the Quran. Did you say wow to that? I hope you did. Because in the Quran, Muhammad is often called the Ummi prophet, the unlettered prophet. They say he was not so literate. He could not read and write prolifically. So, the language of the Quran, absolutely exquisitely beautiful, possibly supernatural. How about Hinduism? One of the top features is its deep philosophy. This is what National Geographic said. "Hindu sages gave to mankind one of the most sophisticated systems of philosophy ever devised. It contains a blend of religion, ethics, civil codes, medicine, mathematics, astronomy, and other natural sciences." Do you know, they wrote this long ago, thousands of years ago. But here's some details. For example, they describe a unit of time. It's called Kalpa. It's 4.5 billion years, one unit. Huge, long. There's another unit of time on the other side called the Kashta. That unit of time is bitty. It's 100 millionth of a second. How would they calculate and how would they gauge such times thousands of years ago? We don't know. But it's absolutely amazing that thousands of years ago, this literature would write such detail and such deep philosophy and put them all together as the writings show today. Amazing Hindu philosophy and information. Amazing, deep, and brilliant. Buddhism, there are three factors: vast, detailed, and mysterious. Let's look at all of them. The Pali canon. Pali is a language. It fills 45 huge volumes. The Chinese scripture consists of 100 volumes of 1,000 closely printed pages each, while the Tibetan extends to 325 volumes. The Buddhist literature is easily the most vast literature in the religious world today. Hundreds of thousands of pages, and half of them have never been translated yet. What about detail? Look at this. The Lord's body had 32 marks of a Superman adorned with the 80 subsidiary characteristics. He was endowed with the 18 special dharmas of a Buddha, mighty with the 10 powers of a Tathagata, and in possession of the 4 grounds of self-confidence. Detailed. The monks were subject to 250 rules known as Pratimoksha rules. How about one of their prayers? "May I be freed at all times from the 4 states of woe, the 3 scourges, the 8 wrong circumstances, the 5 enemies, the 4 deficiencies, the 5 misfortunes, and quickly attain the path." Detail. How about mysteriousness? The bulk of this literature is couched in deliberately mysterious language which would convey nothing to the average reader. Here's one. Suchness. Reality is neither that which is existence nor that which is non-existence, neither that which is at once existence and non-existence, nor that which is not at once existence and non-existence. It is neither that which is unity nor that which is plurality, neither that which is at once unity and plurality, nor that which is not at once unity and plurality. Did you really understand? It's really hard. How about another one? The realization that undifferentiated emptiness is the sole absolute truth. Nirvana is therefore that mental state in which one realizes that all things are really non-existent. You're not supposed to understand it because it is mysterious. You're supposed to use your intuition to understand it. So Buddhism, amazing, awesome, mysterious in its vastness, detail, and the mysteriousness of it. And of course, we can say it is possibly then supernatural. How about the Judeo-Christian writing? We put them together because of this. This is a complex book consisting of 66 individual books written by about 40 human authors over a period of 14 to 1500 years. The spectrum of authors defies any coherent classification, for there were kings, military generals, peasants, philosophers, fishermen, tax collectors, poets, musicians, statesmen, scholars, and shepherds and farmers. But here's one thing that we find. There are attesting cross-references between authors of the Old Testament. For example, Daniel, understood by the books the number of the years specified by the word of the Lord through Jeremiah. Between authors of the New Testament, Peter says, also our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given him, has written to you. Between authors in the New Testament and the Old Testament, so all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet Isaiah. These are the words of Matthew. So each of them is saying, the Lord gave me my message, and this Lord also gave him his message 500 here, 400 years ago. So this Lord was the source throughout the writing of the Bible. Therefore, this source had to live then at least 14 to 1500 years, because that's how long it took to do the writing of the whole book. Therefore, this is humanly impossible to live for 1400 years. The most anyone lives today is about 120 years or so. So all the top features are amazing and highly impressive. They all get excellent marks. So when we review, here's what we find. The New Testament is by far the best attested ancient historical piece of literature in the world. Number two, the Bible is the only writing to possess an open test for possible divine origin. And number three, the cross-referencing by multiple authors points to a possible supernatural feature. Could these point to a red marble?
If you have enjoyed this presentation with Dr. Subodh Pandit and wish to watch more of this unique 13-part series for free online, visit the website godfactorfiction.com. That's godfactorfiction.com. If you would like to order this fascinating series on DVD, it is now available from Whitehorse Media. To order from within the U.S., call 1-800-782-4253. Dr. Subodh Pandit has written two eye-opening books entitled Come Search With Me, Does God Really Exist? And Come Search With Me, The Weight of Evidence, which further explore the topics of evolution, theism, atheism, and religion. To order these books from within the U.S., call 1-800-782-4253. If you live outside the U.S., you may also easily order them on Amazon.com.